Scarif may be the last map to ever be made for Battlefront 2, but it's probably one of the most visually stunning. DICE have really ended their game with a great work of art. Hey everyone, it's Andrew, and welcome to another episode of 50 Insane Details, the series where I find Easter eggs, obscure details, and state the obvious about Star Wars games and topics. Today, I'm going to list 50 insane details about the new Scarif map in Battlefront 2. Each detail just as insane as the last. Scarif is one of my all-time favorite Star Wars locations and is somewhere I'd actually want to visit, because if you ignore the Imperial occupation of the planet, you'll see it's just a tropical holiday paradise. Oh, and some of the details on this list might also cross over with my comparison of Battlefront 1 Scarif with Battlefront 2 Scarif. That was my last video I posted, but let's go. In the sand on the shores of Scarif, if you look closely, you'll see a few little crab-like creatures scuttling their way across the beach. There's no official record of these on Scarif, but they could possibly be Yob shrimp. Originally native to Naboo, Yob shrimp originated from the 1999 video game Star Wars Episode 1: The Gungan Frontier. And now that I know of this game's existence, I need to go play it to discover just how ridiculous it probably is. If you keep watching the crabs, you'll see them stop scuttling and eventually burrow their way into the sand. This is really cool. It's a little cute little crab just going down into the sand. And the crabs also sometimes disappear into the water. Battlefront 2's Scarif map has two destroyed AT-ATs, which have fallen down in the middle of the map. These could possibly be a reference to Walker Assault on Scarif from 2015's Star Wars Battlefront. I really miss Walker Assault. Really want to go play that again. We should do that one day. In the distance, far out from the shore, you'll see a few Imperial walkers, and at first glance, they might look like all-terrain armored cargo transports, AT-ACTs, with the orange-brown cargo section on the body. However, they are in fact just regular old AT-ATs with the cargo body. AT-ACTs have a different head to AT-ATs and are also larger in size. Not sure why DICE didn't create actual AT-ACTs for Scarif. Perhaps it was too much extra work to design the different head, but doesn't seem like that'd be the case. Not sure. The AT-ATs, disguised as AT-ACTs, fire their front blasters at nothing. They just shoot the water up ahead and don't really seem to be aiming for anything in particular. Just trying to intimidate the incoming rebels, I assume. And if you keep watching them for a while, you'll notice they actually get deeper underwater. The legs become more submerged depending on where they are in the ocean. This reminds me of the Kashyyyk mission in Jedi Fallen Order, where you board an AT-AT that's walking through deep water. Around the Scarif map, you'll see several crashed X-Wings, some of which are still on fire, along with several crashed U-Wings. There are two U-Wings which have landed on Scarif and are still intact. These are located at the Rebel spawn, as if they're dropping off the Rebels on Scarif to their doom, because everyone knows what happens on Scarif at the end, you know. Everyone dies. Spoilers. Also, the U-Wing's engines are turned off, which is worth noting. At some of the command posts, you'll find a few consoles that look like this. This is a Rogue One Easter egg. Chirrut Imwe used a console like this to re-establish communication with the Rebel fleet. He pulled this lever here and then died straight afterwards. Close to the center of the map, next to the Imperial Zeta-class shuttle, there's a bunker you can enter and walk around in. There's nothing else in the bunker apart from a few containers. I guess you could use them as cover, but that's about all this bunker's function serves. Maybe they just wanted you to be able to enter a random bunker to say you've been in a bunker on Scarif. You get a little stamp on your Imperial jacket for that. Battlefront 2's Scarif has two different times of day, daytime and sunset. The time of day you play on is randomly selected by the game. It's a 50-50 chance, but I think we all prefer the sunset version. Sunset on Scarif also has these dark gray clouds looming in the sky. I feel like these are here to hint at what happens on Scarif at sunset. I'm sure we all know what happens then. Everyone dies! At sunset, these tall, industrial-looking lights produce light streaks. I wanted to mention this because of how awesome they look. Insane detail right here. Love the lights on Scarif. However, on the daytime version of the map, the lights are still on. The Empire obviously doesn't know much about energy preservation. Gonna have a big electricity bill this month. Who knows? Maybe some Imperial officer will get fired for this, which in the Empire means he'll probably get killed. Okay, it's time to take a look at Scarif's splash physics. You guys know how much I like my splashes. So when jumping from already in the water, you don't create a splash in the water. The same goes for if you're jumping from a ledge or a bridge into the water, still no splash. So I went and got the Rocket Trooper to get some more height, and still, even with the jump pack, no splash. However, firing a blaster into shallow water creates small splashes, and firing a blaster into deeper water creates a slightly larger splash. One thing I will say, I don't think I've ever seen ripple physics quite like the ones in this game. They're very impressive. If you walk around in the water, you'll create a ripple all around you and see the water dragging behind you. And if you stop, the ripple will continue out in front and around you. There are also small and large sized ripples, depending on how much you move. If you jump from already in the water, there's only a small ripple, but a bigger jump and bigger movement creates a bigger ripple. Amazing. Whoever programmed and designed these water ripple effects at DICE, just great job. I also love how wet the water looks as well. I know that sounds kind of strange, but I think this footage gives you an idea of what I mean. It looks very wet. It's great. Okay, now let's talk a little bit about the bushes. Some bushes you can walk through and hide in. It's quite hard to see you when you're hiding inside a bush. You can use this to your advantage in combat. And some bushes you can actually also get on top of and use as a vantage point. You know, the high ground on the bushes. There are two main types of flora on Scarif. One of these fern bushes and the other are palm trees. And there are actually some fallen leaves off the palm trees you'll see on the ground, which have turned brown and died. I think this really adds to the realism of the location and makes it feel like it's a living, breathing planet. Scarif in Rogue One was filmed in the Maldives on a group of islands called Lamu Atoll. Very beautiful place. That's what this location is based on. You might see a lot of people playing as the jump trooper on Scarif, and that's because they can get to parts of the map other trooper classes can't. For example, on top of the Imperial Zeta class shuttle, on top of bunkers, on top of this particular bunker with the railway to the Scarif Citadel Tower, and there's no train that goes between this island and the Citadel Tower in Battlefront 2. But you can jump down onto the tracks and walk around without being electrocuted, probably because there's no train. Like I said in my last video, I really miss being electrocuted by the Scarif railway tracks. On Scarif, there is also no sign of Jyn Erso or Director Krennic anywhere. They're not here. On these containers close to some of the command posts, there are a few letters in Ourobesh, the universal Star Wars language. I translated the Ourobesh. It's a little faded, but the letters you can still make out read E-T-H-X. Perhaps it says the THX, but THX-1138 was the film George Lucas made just before the original Star Wars. THX is also the name of a sound recording and reproduction company founded by Lucas in 1983. They are iconic for that THX sound. I had to play the whole thing because of how impressive it is. There's also a faded logo or insignia on the side of the container. I can't make this out and don't recognize it. So do you know what this is? Because I'm clueless. On Scarif, there are also two docked TIE Strikers, first seen in Rogue One, close to the Imperial spawn. If you walk up on the platform to the TIE Strikers and try open their hatch or interact with them, nothing happens. You can't fly TIE Strikers in Battlefront 2. If you look up into the sky and scan the horizon, you won't see the Death Star. Thought this would be somewhere in the sky, seeing as though, you know, the ending of Battle of Scarif significantly involves the Death Star. Everyone dies! However, in the sky, you will see lots of tiny, faraway X-Wings and TIE Fighters in a large-scale dogfight. Just nowhere near you, so you can't fly any of these ships. In the distance on Scarif, some other details, you'll see faraway islands, more Citadel towers, and more parked Imperial Zeta class shuttles. The command posts on Scarif from co-op are still here in Supremacy, even when you're not playing co-op, and vice versa. The Supremacy posts are also in co-op, although not active. It's interesting that they've left these here. I don't remember them leaving the actual command post thing here on other maps, so maybe that's unique to this map. I could be wrong though. I could just have a bad memory. And number 50, I'm leaving this one up to you guys. What's one detail on Scarif you noticed that perhaps I missed? And what else do you like about this map? Let me know in the comments. And if you'd like to see how this map compares to the Battlefront 1 version of Scarif, go watch this video here. And for more on Star Wars news and gaming, follow me on Instagram, Twitter, and join my Discord. I love this map, the final Battlefront 2 map. Here it is. Thanks for watching this. My name's Andrew. I'll catch you soon.
Stay bombastic.